my name's Katie. I'm a public health nurse with Ottawa Public Health. Today, I'm here with Jen. Jen is a mom of two. She has a 21-year-old and a 13-year-old. And when her daughter was very young, Jen went through some hesitancy when it came to vaccinating her daughter. She's here to talk to us today about her personal story. Hi, Jen. Nice to meet you.
Hi. Nice to meet you, too.
So, Jen, when your daughter, who's 21 now, when she was very young, so a wee baby, when it came time to vaccinating her sort of in that primary series, so that 2 months to 12 months kind of age, tell me a little bit about your thought process when it came to choosing to vaccinate and sort of what you went through during that time.
Well, at that time, I was a single mom. I was young, and I was really struggling with trying to find sort of a community. I didn't really have much community to lean on. I was a solo mom. And so what I found was I had to rely a lot on online sources. So what I did was I reached out, I formed bonds, and I found that I was really anxious about a lot of things. I feel that when you're raising a child, especially on your own, the world is a really big place. It's a very scary place, and you feel like you're both the first and the last defense for that child.
When you started to do your research or to try to understand the decision-making process to vaccinate, tell me a little bit more about that.
The truth is, I was really anxious because this little child, I was her entire world. And so any decision I made for her, I always felt like I'm the one person who has to have her best interest at heart. I'm the one person that she has to rely on. And I was young, I was really insecure. And I kind of felt like there's a risk in everything I do. If I take her outside, I put her in a car, I'm putting her at risk. And maybe that's a very anxious way to be. I was an anxious mom, but I don't think it's an unnatural way to be for a young mom, a single mom, any mom, new mom, right? So when I was looking to vaccinate, I really struggled with the idea that there are inherent risks in vaccination. I'm not a biologist. I'm not someone who understands how these pieces are put together. What's the chemistry? And we're going to inject something into my child. So, you know, logically, you lean on the experts. And I did talk to my doctor. But then I felt so much like, well, my doctor's going to defend the industry. She's going to represent the industry. She's not an objective third party. She's really part of the system. So I did what any logical person would do. And I looked for my answers online. And what I found was that there was a massive amount of information online available to people like me, talking about adverse reactions, talking about what can go wrong, the damage that could be done to your child today, tomorrow, in the future. And it was overpowering. It was really terrifying. And so my natural instinct was, I'm not going to do that to her. And so I went back to my doctor and I rejected some of her vaccines. And I actually stood by that decision for a very long time. So from until she was about 5 years old, I refused the vaccines, and I absolutely believed that what I was doing was the right thing because I was trying to protect her. And it wasn't until she was going to start kindergarten, so senior kindergarten, and they asked for her vaccine certificate. And I didn't have one for a few select vaccines, and they told me I was going to have to sign a letter of exemption based on conviction. So I took the form home, and I thought about it for a really long time. And at the same time, just sort of simultaneous with all of that, the news was coming out of Toronto that there was a measles outbreak. And that measles outbreak was very selectively located in an area that was known to have a high concentration of people who hadn't vaccinated their child. And that wouldn't necessarily have struck me, except that so many of the children ended up in the ICU. And it stunned me a little bit to think, like, in my mind, I wasn't vaccinating because I wanted to protect her from something that could cause an adverse reaction. But if I don't do something, is that better? Because there's an adverse reaction to not doing something if you're caught in the wrong situation. I can't guarantee she wouldn't be in that same situation. I started really thinking about the information I was reading and what it came across as. people who are talking about not vaccinating speak with a lot of emotion. There's a lot of fear underlying it all, but the emotion is what bad can happen to your child. This terrible event, there's a lot of clarifiers, a lot of adjectives, and it's just very emotive. It really draws on your fear, and you place yourself into the word you're reading, and you're like, no, I don't want that. But then when you read the pro-vaccination camp, it's very clinical. I would almost say it's boring. It's difficult to read. It doesn't tell you like you're going to save your child's life, and it doesn't emote for you. It's sort of like, here's the information, here's the list, here are some adverse reactions, here are some, potential outcomes. Yes, there's a percentage. So it doesn't restrict you from having fear. It doesn't take your fear and, soothe it. It just gives you information. That's all it is. And so I really had to think about it and think, wait, if I strip away all of the emotion from the anti-vaccine camp, what do I have left? And I found that there wasn't a lot of information. So the data that was clinical and boring on the pro-vaccine camp was data. Strip the emotion from the anti-vaccine camp and there's no data. It was just a lot of people agreeing with each other. And that's actually what really struck me was, if I stick to this idea that I've got, I'm kind of basing it on nothing. And then I realized, bottom line, as a parent, I want to be the parent who, if I have to put my child in a difficult position, that could be a position of potential adverse outcomes one way or the other, I want to be the parent that did something to protect my child, not the parent who hoped for the best. The other reality is, if I wait for nature to take its course, the outcomes could be anything. You don't know when, you don't know how bad. You have to sort of wait and see, where if you get a vaccine, there are some adverse reactions. It's a rock and a hard place. Every parent has to make that decision. But you know when you administered the medication, you know what the potential outcomes are. You wait in the doctor's office for the most likely period of time when something bad could happen, and there are doctors there absolutely ready and prepared to take care of your child right then. So you're not sitting at home, getting ready for bed and then suddenly going, oh my God, how do I deal with this? You're sitting in a doctor's office in a very controlled environment. You can't say the same for any of these diseases you're vaccinating against.
Based on sort of what you just told me, I think so many other parents can relate to this. When you chose to go ahead and vaccinate, you took your daughter, you went and did it. Can you explain how you felt once you made that decision?
I'm going back 15 years, 16 years. So it's a bit of a tough analysis to go back to. But once I made my decision, once I sort of established that the anti-vaccine information I'd been reading was not equal to the pro-vaccine information, it's how I was reading it that really set the tone for how I was interpreting it. Once I made the decision to choose vaccination, I stood by it 100%. And I absolutely thought this was the best choice for my daughter. And it was backed by science. It was backed by thousands of people. Thousands have gone before me. It was backed by an entire history of people who've been protected from disease.
So Jen, with COVID-19 vaccines being around now for almost a year and a half, and with the introduction of the COVID vaccine for the 5 to 11 age group, because your kids are a little bit older now, if they were in that age group, that 5 to 11, how would you feel about approaching the decision, or how would you make the decision to vaccinate? Can you talk a little bit about that?
I can say without a doubt that I would be getting my children vaccinated as quickly as possible. And part of that comes from the experience of having gotten my 13-year-old vaccinated, right? I mean, he's not that far beyond the 5 to 11-year-olds. And as soon as they opened the door to get 13-year-old vaccinated, I was online registering him at 8 a.m. He was among the first of his age group getting out there. And to be honest, the relief I felt at knowing my family was protected, and in the entirety, that was huge. And I think about the parents that have had for the past 6 months to live this split life, right? This parents are vaccinated, children are not. You feel protected, but then you realize, no, we're only partially protected. Anything I do can still impact my children. What a terrible feeling that must be. And I'm celebrating every family that does get their child vaccinated.
That's so nice. I think, you know, people in your circle who have that support, it's nice to feel validated in your decision. And I think it's important, especially as parents, as moms, that we do support other people, and we also listen to those who are struggling, who are unsure, because it's not about this or that or them and these old people over here. It's really about having sort of a conversation, an open dialogue that is judgment-free. I really appreciate that you took the time to talk to me today, and it was so lovely to meet you. Thank you, Jen.
No problem.
If you have any more questions about the COVID-19 vaccine for children, please visit our website, ottawapublichealth.ca/childcovid-19vaccine. Thanks for watching.